King Ludwig II of Bavaria is probably one of the most controversial and most fascinating monarchs in modern European history. Rumoured to have suffered severe mental disorders, he's a prime example of what happens when you put an apathetic and delusional person on the throne of a powerful European state. He wanted to be an absolutist monarch in a rapidly changing environment where the idea of power resting in the hands of a sole person quickly came out of fashion. He frequently juggled with the thought of just abdicating and leaving it all behind, and he built some of Germany's most famous tourist attractions. Let's take a closer look at the life of Bavaria's so-called Märchenkönig, or Fairy Tale King. Otto Friedrich Wilhelm Ludwig was born on the 25th of August 1845 in the Nymphenburg Palace in Munich. Just 3 years later, he became crown prince when his grandfather was forced to abdicate under the immense pressure caused by an angry populace demanding more rights in the revolution of 1848. Ludwig was still an 18-year-old student when his father suddenly died a few years later, and he became the king of a vast territory in southern Germany. When he ascended the throne, Bavaria was inhabited by roughly 5 million people, around 3/4 of whom still lived in rural areas. However, the country was industrialising rapidly. The railway network was growing on a yearly basis, telegraph lines were established all over the country, and all the major cities were gas-lit. In terms of political freedoms, Bavaria was also quite progressive. Press freedom had been in effect for decades, and one of the two legislative houses was democratically elected by the adult male populace. Then again, the representatives were only able to vote for tax increases and new laws, while all the ministers of state were directly appointed by the king. Hopes were high when Ludwig ascended the throne. Many hoped that he would enact even more reforms and modernise the country further, but their hopes were ill-placed because the king rarely ever showed himself and instead preferred to spend time outside of Munich with his new friend, the composer Richard Wagner. Wagner didn't make a lot of friends in Bavaria because it soon became clear just how much influence he had on the young king and what a ridiculously luxurious life the musician had started to live. Under pressure from the ministers, Ludwig had no choice but to expel his close friend. There wasn't much time to mourn, however, because a war was on the horizon. For several years now, both Prussia and Austria had been vying for the dominant position within the German Confederation. Although both countries had teamed up to fight a war against Denmark just 2 years prior, Otto von Bismarck was now trying to form a German state under Prussian leadership. And Austria was in the way. The opportunity for that came in 1866, when Prussia occupied Austrian-administered Holstein. Austria quickly encouraged all members of the Confederation to march against Prussia, a call which was followed by Hanover, Saxony, and 10 other states. For Bavaria, the question of whose side to join wasn't that easy. Ludwig would have preferred it if the kingdom could just stay neutral, because he himself had close family ties to both countries, and because the army was just not in a good state to fight in. But that simply wasn't an option, because staying neutral would have meant being an enemy in Bismarck's eyes. In the end, Austria seemed to have been the better choice, because it could at least guarantee Bavarian sovereignty. Ludwig was absolutely devastated after making that decision and was seriously considering abdicating and joining his friend Wagner in his Swiss exile. Funnily enough, it was Wagner of all people who encouraged him to keep going instead. And that's what Ludwig did. He visited the army barracks in Bamberg, where he received an incredibly warm welcome and where he managed to motivate his soldiers. But that's also where his sudden enthusiasm ended. After his visit, he retreated back to his fruitful life on Rose Island and never again seemed to care much about the war. Ludwig's faith in Austria was misplaced, however, because just 7 weeks after the war broke out, Austria and Bavaria were forced to concede defeat. Austria was kicked out of the German Confederation, Prussia annexed big swaths of land, and Bavaria was forced to pay reparations as well as enter a military alliance with Prussia. After his humiliating defeat, Ludwig's popularity was at an all-time low. The fact that he just stayed on his little island while thousands of people were dying horribly didn't exactly evoke the most supportive emotions among the populace for the young king. On top of that, rumours about him having homoerotic relationships with a number of men started to spread like a wildfire. It became especially ugly when it came to light that Ludwig personally protected a young stable lad who was accused of rape. To save face and to preserve his authority, the king toured Franconia, where he donated money to the poor, visited wounded soldiers in the military hospitals, and organised a number of parades. When he returned to his self-imposed isolation to Berg Castle, the entire world around him seemed to be purposefully acting against his perception of what it means to be a monarch. He wished to be like Louis XIV, an absolutist king who exerts authority over every aspect of the state. Ludwig lived out his delusional fantasy by inventing a new way to walk, and by strolling through his park wearing a crown and holding a scepter. He writes, "The principle of people's authority, which is increasingly forming itself and is poisoning everything with its venom, must be eradicated. In a monarchy, as it must be, everything should emanate from the monarch like the rays of the sun and refer back to him. He should be the head, the soul, and therefore the real lifeblood of the state." How very humble. But it might indeed have appeared as if everything conspired to remove as much power from him as possible. He didn't have the support of his parliament, and the Kingdom of Prussia was planning to finally bring about the unification of Germany. He was, again, not left with much choice but to march with Prussia when the war against France began in 1870. In autumn, when France was on the edge of defeat, voices for a unified German Empire under Prussian leadership became increasingly louder, even in Bavaria. It would have meant the end of the more than a century-old kingdom, and to Ludwig, this was a catastrophe. But what could he do? The decision to accept the Prussian King Wilhelm I as the German Emperor became a lot easier when Bismarck offered Ludwig a humble and secret gift of just about 300,000 goldmarks every year, on top of a hefty sum of money paid up front. In total, Ludwig would receive 6 million marks by the end of 1886. In return, he sent the so-called Kaiserbrief to the Prussian Chancellor, where he agreed that Bavaria and the other South German states become part of the German Empire. In January of 1871, the Bavarian Parliament agreed to that decision, and with that, Ludwig's kingdom was gone. His worldview was shattered. It was behind this background that his public appearances decreased even more. He started to retreat more and more to his private residences, leaving tasks like state visits and ceremonies to his family members. In 1875, he showed himself publicly for the last time at a military parade. Once again, he waged the thought of simply abdicating and moving abroad where he could rule however he wanted. Ludwig sent the Privy Councillor Franz von Luer to several parts of the world to find a quite sublime land. Many places came into consideration, such as Cyprus, the Crimean Peninsula, the Azores, Crete, Egypt, Brazil, or even Afghanistan. In the end, however, none of these plans came to fruition. There was just no realistic way he could establish the kingdom of his dreams in some faraway land. So, he decided that he might not even have to leave Bavaria to create his fairy realm. Already in 1869, he ordered the construction of a new medieval-style castle next to his family residence of Hohenschwangau. Today, this castle is known as Neuschwanstein Castle. A few years later, inspired by the palace in Versailles, the Linderhof Palace was built, with a massive garden and with water fountains. Shortly after, he decided it was time for castle number 3, and it was the most expensive of the lot. On the Herreninsel, he built a massive complex of buildings, all of which took just about 16 years to build. But, as you may know, castles cost money. A lot of money. Ludwig's private treasury was quickly depleting, and in 1882 he was already struggling to pay his bills on time. 3 years later, his debts amounted to about 14 million marks. Ludwig's reckless spending sparked some serious doubt into the minds of the king's cabinet, who were starting to realise that he just wasn't fit to rule. The university professor Bernhard von Gutten was appointed with the task of finding out more about Ludwig's mental health. He quickly came to the conclusion that he was originally crazy. Four neurologists confirmed von Gutten's assumption and declared him unfit to rule. His Majesty is mentally disturbed to a very advanced degree, and in fact, they suffer from that form of mental illness which is well known to psychiatrists from experience under the name of paranoia, was cited as the official reason. A commission was sent to Neuschwanstein to pick up Ludwig and to take him to Berg Palace, where he was placed under constant surveillance. Now, whether Ludwig was actually mentally ill remains a highly controversial question, which is being heavily discussed to this day. Some claim that there is no reason to believe that there was anything wrong with his mind, especially considering Ludwig's situation in the wider monarchist context. Their main argument is that the diagnosis was conducted on the mere basis of letters and witness testimonies without having actually talked to the king. Others claim that the diagnosis was indeed correct and that Ludwig might have suffered from schizotypal personality disorder. So, which side is correct now? Don't ask me, I'm not a psychologist. You can make up your own mind, I'll leave the two most convincing reports in the description. Be that as it may, Ludwig's doctors didn't get the chance to cure him, because on the 13th of June 1886, both the former king's and Bernhard von Gunn's bodies were found floating in the lake just a few hours after they had embarked on a walk. The circumstances behind their mysterious deaths have not been cleared up to this very day. Some assume it was suicide, others claim it was cold-blooded murder, others speculate that he tried to escape his captivity by just swimming away. Ludwig's life and his strange death fascinate people from all over the world to this day, and his legacy still lives on in the form of the magnificent castles he left behind.